Simon & Schuster Audio presents Wonderland, a tale of hustling hard and breaking even by Nicole Treska, read by the author.
For my family. Telemachus's detachment. When I was a child, looking at my parents' lives, you know what I thought? I thought heartbreaking. Now I think heartbreaking, but also insane. Also very funny. Louise Gluck. Prologue. Mystic City by the Sea. How do you turn the province of drunks, sailors, and hookers into a dream of bright escape? You build Wonderland, one of America's first amusement parks located on the water right outside of Boston. The park only operated for a few bright seasons, from 1906 to 1910, but its legacy shines on. Wonderland was built just off Revere Beach, a long, rough crescent of soft sand where over a century of Bostonians, including my entire family, escaped the broiling New England heat. Developers tried and failed to make a go of the Revere waterfront for years before the park was built. The beach was accessible, served by a narrow-gauge railroad, but it was also known for its criminal element. At the beginning of the 20th century, amusement parks were built in resort towns and on boardwalks all over the East Coast, so Revere got another shot. Wonderland was built over a marsh bought cheap, with rides and designs borrowed from the Chicago World's Fair, the St. Louis Expo, and Brooklyn's Dreamland Amusement Park in Coney Island. And while compound financial disasters would close Wonderland's gates after only five seasons, its opening day saw 100,000 residents arrive by railroad in their Sunday best. Working-class Bostonians from the West End strolled alongside Jamesian Back Bay elites. The entrance on Walnut Avenue shone with 30,000 lights, under which patrons passed into the promenade. The electric lights at Wonderland were as big a sell as any of the attractions, and the park capitalized on their dazzle. The parades and entrances lit up the North Shore. An elevated boardwalk circled a central canal where Shoot the Chutes, an early version of a log ride, sent thrilled patrons in skiffs skidding out across the water. Wonderland's chutes were the biggest in the world, brought to Revere direct from the St. Louis Expo. The scenic railway followed the park's perimeter, carrying Bostonians far above the silted band between the firmament of East Boston and the Broad Sound. Next to Shoot the Chutes, the Infant Incubator Pavilion advertised living infants. Steel boxes sat in clean lines, and a pipe along the ceiling delivered oxygen to each incubator. The babies inside were visible behind glass doors and monitored by visitors and a full medical staff. Other amusement parks across the country featured infant incubators as well. Premature babies weren't given great odds at survival, and Dr. Martin A. Cooney wanted to show people that with warmth, protection, and clean air to breathe, these newborns could survive their circumstances. A safe space for babies was a radical new idea. Many of the park's larger attractions were meant to reveal the far-off world to Bostonians and bring it closer. Shows like Pawnee Bill's Great Wild West, The Japanese Village, and The South Before the War were enormous productions built on lots that housed hundreds of performers and elaborate sets. They were also built on flagrant stereotypes and exploitation and were criticized even at the time. In between lots, there were sideshows, funhouses, pageants, and talent shows to stoke the wonder of anyone with 5 cents to spare. Some of Wonderland's rides and attractions must have been cathartic to witness. Fighting the Flames was a headline attraction where the facade of a town square burned every night. Guests packed an amphitheater and watched the drama unfold. The townspeople on stage swept sidewalks and bought vegetables. they were unaware of the curling smoke that the audience witnessed. The crowd celebrated as heroic off-duty firefighters arrived to extinguish the all-engulfing flames. No one died when the square burned. No one was ruined. No one's business or home disappeared just like that. It was a roaring good time, a simulated disaster, a controlled burn. Bostonians knew fire and flames. Less than 40 years before, the Great Boston Fire of 1872 rolled across the city, burning the most beautiful blocks you'd never see, the whole of the financial district, the entire downtown. Sketches of the aftermath showed a city of rubble, ruins, something ancient and gone forever. The Cyclone roller coaster, built along Revere Beach in 1925, burned down in 1969. My mom, my dad, my entire family still talk about the roller coaster that existed for them, but never for me. Under the Sea joined Wonderland after the first season. It featured an enormous tank where Houdini knockoffs broke free of their complicated bindings and swam for fresh air. Divers in heavy suits walked underwater under enormous pressure. Women in mermaid suits looped the depths of the tank, their long hair haloed toward the surface. The newspapers called the performers human fish. In 1919, almost a decade after Wonderland closed, a 50-foot tank of molasses exploded on Commercial Street in Boston's North End. A faulty, overfull tank with bad rivets burst on a warm January afternoon, and 2 million gallons of molasses flooded the streets in a 35-mile-per-hour, 15-foot wave. Shrapnel from the tank tore through the steel beams of buildings. The heavy molasses, under pressure, flowed like water. Its viscous mass destroyed the neighborhood, killing some on impact and suffocating others in its dark amber. The North End smelled sweet for years. Wonderland's descent to Hellgate spiraled riders through Dantean circles of hell in a boat before dropping them precipitously into the underworld, where they met the devil on his throne before they could meet daylight again. My family circled around and around, though daylight often eluded us. For instance, the Boston Globe detailed my father's arrest for federal drug trafficking in 1985. He walked into work at the post office and was tackled by federal agents in a sting operation, a real sticky situation. We saw him out on bail before he went to prison for 2 years. When he got out, I was 7, and my younger sister Lindsay was 4. She didn't remember him. My family met the devil regularly. Finally, there was Love's Journey. The ride was advertised as crazy, sentimental, and sensational. It promised a revolutionary experience that spun lovers in suspended rotation through the various stages of romance. There were children dressed as cherubs, heart-shaped carts, and a confusion of confetti dumped on riders' heads. This roving search felt familiar, too. Aren't we all out searching for love? The cyclone's ruins came down in 1974, 5 years after it burned, and 5 years before I was born. The blizzard of 78 swept homes into the sea, up and down Revere Beach. The storm permanently shuttered storefronts and destroyed the seawall. After that, only seedy clubs and bars returned to the strip. The last vestiges of the mystic city by the sea were defeated by fire and ice. During my childhood in the 1980s and 1990s, murders spiked. Swimming was banned because of water pollution, and a day at the beach represented a real dedication to the cause. Yet even then, there we were, slathered in sunscreen. Stay close to the wall, my mother would tell us. Watch out for needles. Don't get in too deep. Don't drown. Don't drown. This was, and still is, the Boston model of progress. If you live under its lofty blueprint, get ready for a brutal sea change. Wonderland, Logan Airport, Government Center, Mass General, the Big Dig. Boston's rich history of greased handshakes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.